Okay, there we go. Good stuff. Okay, so last time we were here, we started detailing the chapter on HIP, chapter 17. I'm not going to recover all of this. We'll hit a little bit of this. We covered this on Thursday evening, so I'm not going to re-lecture the whole thing. Just kind of re-mention some things. Understanding that the hip joint is the articulation between the acetabulum of the pelvis and the femur. So it's the actual acetabulum of the pelvis mixed with the femur to form the actual hip joint. So our hip joint is a formation. We did talk about the acetabulum being concave. The head of the femur is convex. The largest convex surface on the body, actually. So we talked about it being a synovial joint. It is a true ball and socket. The head of the femur looks like a ball. The acetabulum looks like a true socket. It is a triaxial joint, means it moves in all three planes, frontal, sagittal, and transverse plane, about all three axes. We talked about movement in open chain versus movement in closed chain. So that's going to be really important that you're able to dissect that in your mind. Remember, we said open chain movement is when my foot is not fixated to the floor. So if I'm standing here just swinging my leg back and forth, that's open chain. This foot is not connected to the floor, so it has free rein. So when I'm doing open chain movement, it is my femur that is moving on my pelvis. My convex femur moves on my concave acetabulum. So it's the femur moving on the pelvis when it's open chain. When it's closed chain, so if I'm standing here and instead of swinging my foot forward, I'm weight bearing and I'm now bending forward, moving my pelvis on my hip, like I'm bending forward to reach for my toes, then that's closed chain. And now I am moving my fixed, I'm moving my pelvis over my fixed femur. So open chain, I'm doing this. Femur moves on acetabulum, like I'm kicking my leg. Wah! Superman kick. Wah! Closed chain, femur is fixed, and I'm moving my pelvis on my femur. Make sense? So open chain, I'm moving my femur on my pelvis. Closed chain, I'm moving my pelvis on my femur. Okay, we talked about the different movement structures that we can have as it relates to the lower extremity. Remember, we said true extension of the hip is not what you're seeing there in the photograph. This is not extension. This is called return from flexion. So this picture here where it shows extension is not extension. It's called return from flexion. So this is not extension. Extension is literally moving the body, moving the hip, or moving the femur behind the pelvis. So if I'm standing and I'm kicking backwards, somebody comes up behind you, scares you, and you kick them out of the way. Wah! That's extension. This is called return from flexion. So that is not true extension. Okay? Just a reminder there. But yes, it performs, again, in all three planes. It flexes, it extends. So flexion, kicking forward, extension, backwards, abduction to the side. Adduction is actually coming back to neutral. Moving the leg in front of the opposite leg is a form of horizontal adduction. No different than doing this with my upper extremity. Make sense? So that's horizontal adduction. That's not true adduction, what they're showing here. That's horizontal adduction. True adduction is coming back to the zero angle. Then we have internal external rotation or medial lateral rotation. Again, both terms are important to know because you're going to have people who use both terms depending on where you go. We talked about the infill. We said the infill is going to be soft for flexion. All the other ones will be firm because of all the ligaments that help to hold things together. We'll get to angle of inclination and all of that. We talked about different ligaments that support the hip. We talked about ligamentous teres, the ligament that actually holds the femoral head into the acetabulum. So it's the ligament that literally helps to hold the femoral head into the acetabulum, locks it into place. We said that there is a artery that runs inside of ligamentum teres called artery to the head of the femur, or the fovea artery. And its job is to provide blood supply to the head of the femur and keep it viable and alive. We said once we damage that artery, then we're going to get something called necrosis. I don't think we said that word, but that's a word that you'll hear. Femoral head necrosis, N-E-C-R-O-S-I-S, meaning femoral head death. So the head of the femur dies off in what's called necrosis, and now you need a hip replacement. So there are some people who have traumatic tears of ligamentum teres and the artery to the head of the femur, and they end up needing hip replacements at a very young age. We highlighted one such person. Anybody remember? Thank you. Somebody was listening that day. Not everybody was asleep. Thank you. Bo Jackson. Yes. Bo Jackson was one person who had a traumatic tear of this ligament and ended up needing surgery and became the only player to ever return back to playing pro baseball with an artificial hip. True story. Then we talked about the joint capsule. We said every capsule has four specific things. Every capsule has four specific things. What are those four things? I'll take it. Good job. So every synovial joint has four components. I won't give those again because we've talked about it now for 4 months in a row. Know the four components. We said that the hip joint is very cool because it's also supported by hip ligaments. We said there are three ligaments that provide structural support to the hip joint. One is my favorite ligament in the human body because it has the coolest name ever, the Y ligament of Bigelow, or the iliofemoral ligament. Adds support and protects against hip extension, excessive extension. Then we have pubofemoral ligament, which is underneath that, that's going to help with hip extension. If I'm not mistaken, I think it's adduction as well, or abduction, yep. And posteriorly, we have ischiofemoral coming off of the ischial spine there, and it's going to help to protect against extension and medial rotation. So those are the ligaments that support the hip. Very much so important. Then we talked about another ligament that's very important for the hip and for its structure called the inguinal ligament. It runs from the ASIS to the pubic tubercle coming across. We said it's really important because it separates certain structures. One structure that we are able to identify, or three structures, are the femoral nerve, artery, and vein. So, or the femoral nave going lateral to medial. So going from the lateral side to the medial side, it's femoral nerve, femoral artery, femoral vein. So we said if you find your femoral pulse in your hip, you're right near femoral nerve. That's why that's important. We said femoral artery is really cool. It actually changes names just based on passing the inguinal ligament. Before it passes it, it's the external iliac artery. Once it passes inguinal ligament, it just changes names to femoral artery. It's pretty cool. Doesn't do anything different, just change names. Talked about the IT band and why it's important, its structure and its function. It's a muscle attacher. We talked about another cool structure, the adductor hiatus. It's a literal hole in the muscle that is there because the femoral artery and the femoral vein will pass through it. So you can see it going down through it here on the second picture right here. See femoral nerve and femoral artery going down through the adductor hiatus right about here. So it's going to go from anterior, so it starts out anterior, so it's here. Then in the distal part of the anterior thigh, it's going to dive through the adductor hiatus and come out posterior, like we're seeing here. So this is it coming out posterior through the adductor hiatus. Once it comes out posteriorly, it will again change names for the third time, and it becomes the popliteal artery and the popliteal vein. So if you're looking on the back of a leg, you'll actually see it here. So the red that you see there is the popliteal artery in the back side of the leg on this structure here after it passes through the adductor hiatus. Then one of the last structures we talked about was the pes anserine, or if you're old school like I am, pes anserinus. So I grew up calling it that, so I'm probably going to keep calling it that because Frank Netter did, and I like Frank Netter. So it's the pes anserinus. The book has pes anserine, it's up to you. Either way, it's translated in Greek to goose's foot. So it looks like the foot of a goose, I guess. I don't know. I've never picked up a goose or geese. Goose. It's geese plural, goose. I thought so. Okay. I've never picked up a goose. I've never held geese. There we go. That's the way you say it. Look at that. I went to English class. I've never held geese, so I don't know what it looks like, but they say it looks like this, so oh well. We'll go with it. So pes anserine or pes anserinus, and it is the attachment site of three primary muscles that help to move the hip and the knee. And so it is an attachment site for those on the medial aspect of the proximal tibia. So this is found on the medial aspect of the proximal tibia. This structure here is really good to see in case you ever wanted to see what we're talking about. Here are the three coming down, and that is the pes anserinus right in there. So it really is a functional place. Let me put it up here. This leg is heavy. Yep. So if you wanted to see it, those are the three muscles coming in, and that's pes anserinus right in here, proximal anterior tibia. Okay. Alrighty. Then we started diving into the muscles. So we started to get into the muscles. That's kind of where we're going to pick up on today. So we covered all of the muscles that help to move the hip into flexion anteriorly. So it's important that we know those. The first one we talked about was iliopsoas. We said iliopsoas is a combination of actually three different muscles that blend together and all insert on the same place, which will be the lesser trochanter. So in the hip, it's called a tubercle. On the shoulder, it's called a tubercle. On the hip, it's called a trochanter. this big bump thing here. So this is greater, this is lesser trochanter. Greater tubercle, lesser tubercle. See, just change the name. Trochanters. So all of the three muscles of the iliopsoas will insert on lesser trochanter of the femur. So we talked about iliacus will originate in the iliac fossa. So that's actually on the pelvis. That's this structure right here on the anterior side of the pelvis. All of this structure right in here is the iliac fossa. So it'll originate on the iliac fossa. We said that psoas major and minor are going to originate on the body and the disc and the transverse process, if I'm not mistaken, of T12 through L5. Yes. And they're both going to insert on lesser trochanter of the femur. We said something interesting about iliopsoas. It's just like brachialis of the arm, meaning it what? Prime flexor of the hip. Very good. So if you know what brachialis does, then that should make sense. When you hear that, you go, oh, wow, yeah. So no matter what position the hip is in, iliopsoas is a muscle that will flex the hip. It's going to always flex the hip. It is the prime flexor of the hip. Okay, moved on from there. We started talking about big chunking muscle right here in the front of the thigh. Can't miss it. Rectus femoris, that's it right here. In case you were wondering where it is, it's right there, rectus femoris. We said it's almost the longest muscle in the human body because it's going to originate on the anterior inferior iliac spine. It's going to insert on the tibial tuberosity, which is down here, this bump in the front of the leg. You can actually find tibial tuberosity. We will eventually do that via the patellar tendon, and we'll make that make sense pretty soon. We said that it, because it crosses both the hip, meaning it's going to originate on AIIS, which is about right about here, and it's going to cross the hip joint here, it's going to cross the knee joint. It is a two-joint muscle, and it's going to have an effect on both joints. So it cannot be a prime flexor of the hip if it's also engaged in doing extension of the knee. So if I'm extending my knee, my rectus can't assist in flexing my hip. So rectus, it takes rectus out from doing both jobs well. That's called active insufficiency. It's going to be innervated femoral nerve. The longest muscle in the body, distinction goes to another muscle that flexes the hip, the sartorius. Sartorius, some people put the long R there, it's up to you. Some people call it sartorius, some people call it sartorius, or sartorius, S-A-R, sore. So it's up to you, however you want to pronounce it, as long as you know what it does. Originates anterior superior iliac spine, so it's going to be a little bit higher up than rectus, and it's going to insert on the pes anserinus coming around. It's one of the muscles inserting on that goose's foot we just finished talking about. It has a very cool function. It won't just independently flex the hip. When it does hip flexion, it does all of its combined motions. Because it's a muscle that literally wraps around the body, going from lateral to medial, when it contracts, it's going to flex the hip, abduct it, and laterally rotate it. So we said it's the same action as stacking one leg on top of the other. So if you're doing this, you are using your sartorius. Okay, ASIS, pes anserinus, and it's going to also be innervated by femoral nerve. So all of the flexors are innervated by femoral nerve, except psoas major and minor. It's just nerve roots of L2, 3. Okay, so that leads us to where we wanted to get to today. Any questions? None. Either I did a good job of summary or still have sleep from the weekend. Either way, we're going to make it work. So let's dive in now. We're going to put in the muscles that are responsible for adducting the hip. Muscles responsible for adduction of the hip, adduction, pulling the hip into the midline. So that's what we're going to start dealing with. The first one we're going to do is called the pectineus muscle. Some people want to call it pectineus, but it's actually pectineus muscle. Is the name of the muscle. So the pectineus muscle is a short muscle that's going to insert pretty much proximal, and it's going to insert pretty much proximal on the femur. So let's get it. It's going to originate on the superior ramus of the pubis bone. So superior ramus. So that's why it's important that we know all these structures. Superior ramus, right in here. Superior ramus of the pubis, and it's going to insert on the pectineal line of the femur, which we will show you that pectineal line of the femur, or you can just put proximal femur. It's the pectineal line, but it's the proximal femur. So the book has it as a hip flexor, but it's really hip flexion with adduction. So it brings it across and adducts. So it's more this motion. If you're bringing your leg up and across, you're coming up to knee across the body. Flexion with adduction. Pectineus. Not very strong because it's not that much of a lever. It's not very long muscle, so it does help, but it's not that strong. Femoral nerve also innervates it. Flexor of the group, innervated by femoral nerve. Okay, now we're going to add in the three named muscles that perform adduction, adduction. So there are actually three muscles named for adduction. That's pretty cool. Then there'll be one more that's a really long one that will add to it, gracilis. But these are the three muscles that are actually named for adduction. There's an adductor longus, adductor brevis, and an adductor magnus. Okay. So let's start to see these. So the first one we will see, you can see all three of them on figure 1722, page 303. You can see why they're actually termed what they're termed. So the longus is a little bit more inferior on the femur than the brevis. They'll originate from the same place. So adductor longus as well as adductor brevis will originate on the pubic symphysis, so we don't worry about that inferior ramus as much. Pubic symphysis, I'm saying that wrong, excuse me, here we go. Yeah. So, no, yeah, anterior pubis, not the pubic round. Like pubic symphysis, it doesn't innervate on the pubic symphysis. So, yeah, anterior pubic bone. So just on the anterior pubis. And it's going to insert on the middle line of the femur. We'll show you what the linear aspirate is, but just think midline or the midpoint of the femur. It's going to insert kind of on the midpoint of the femur. Because it's named something adductor, it only makes sense that it performs hip adduction. So it's a hip adductor, adductor longus. And it's going to be innervated by a new nerve that we're going to introduce, the obturator nerve. So we've talked about femoral nerve. Now we're talking about obturator nerve. So that's adductor longus. Brevis, you can consider it the same thing. Just think anterior pubis. We don't have to go into detail about all of the ramuses and things like that. Just anterior pubis. And it's going to be on the proximal end of the femur. So it's going to be proximal end of the femur. Same motions, same nerve. Adductor brevis. Slightly shorter than adductor longus. Both still are powerful adductors of the hip. Okay. Then the next one we'll talk about is the adductor magnus. Adductor magnus. And so if you look here on adductor magnus, you'll see a triangular slit in the muscle right here. That triangular slit that you're looking at is the adductor hiatus. That's literally a hole in the muscle. So the triangular slit here in the muscle is going to be the adductor hiatus. So right in here, this triangular slit is the adductor hiatus. That's where femoral nerve and artery will pass through and become popliteal nerve and artery on the backside of the knee. So adductor magnus is going to originate on the ischial tuberosity, so the inferior part here, and the inferior pubic ramus. So here, and then inferior pubic ramus, all down this area here. It's going to insert on the entire length of the medial femur, or it talks about the entire linea aspera, except for the place where there's a slit in the muscle due to the adductor hiatus. And it's going to end up having the same action. It is a cool muscle, because it's going to be innervated by two named nerves. We'll cover a couple of other things that are innervated by two named nerves. Pec major was actually innervated by two named nerves. Upper and lower pectoral nerves. But it's innervated by obturator and a new nerve name that we haven't talked about, the sciatic nerve. Sciatic nerve. Sciatic nerve is the largest nerve in the human body. It actually runs on the posterior aspect of the leg, innervating a lot of structures there. It's actually a combination of two separate nerves that have blended together and produce movement. The two nerves are sciatic nerve. The two nerves are going to be tibial nerve and common perineal or peroneal. I may be spelling it wrong. So sciatic nerve is a combination of two separate nerves. Peroneal, I think it's perineal, peroneal. Some people call it peroneal. Let me get my guy out of the way here. I think now they're starting to call it the common fibular nerve. So, stuff changes overnight. But adductor magnus, the long adductor of the hip. Ischial tuberosity, pubic ramus inserts on the adductor tubercle, which is medial. It's the entire length of the femur, and the adductor tubercle. We'll find that shortly. And then the last adductor muscle, it's not a very strong muscle because it's not very long, but it does have a good function. And that's called the gracilis muscle. Gracilis. It's going to originate on the inferior pubic ramus. And it's going to insert on the pes and serinus, along with sartorius, which we've already discussed. There'll be one more later. So the pes and serinus so far has an attachment from sartorius, gracilis. The way it gets to pes and serinus is really cool. It does not run on the front side of the knee joint. It actually goes behind the knee and then comes out front once it's past the knee joint. And that's important because it's going to be a adductor of the hip, but it's also a weak flexor of the knee, because it passes posteriorly or behind the knee joint. So it's going to cause the knee to flex. Okay, it's a good place for a break. Take five. We'll be back about 10:15. Brevis, one's medium length, so it's longest. One is really large, so it's called magnus. So the leg is really easy to understand. So the three adductors of the hip, three of the adductors of the hip are all named after adductor. One is short, brevis. One is a little bit longer, longest. One goes all the way down and is really large, magnus. Then we have gracilis, which adducts the hip, but because it crosses the knee, meaning it's not going to cross the knee on the front side, it's not coming from here going down and crossing the knee on the front of the knee. It comes behind the knee and then insert on pes and serinus. It's also going to be a flexor of the knee. So it's a two-joint muscle that flexes the knee. So far we've talked about three two-joint muscles. Rectus was one, sartorius was two, gracilis is three. We have a few more, not a whole lot, about three more. I take that back. Depends on how you look at some other stuff. We'll see. We'll talk about it. So we have four that flex the hip, rectus femoris, iliopsoas, sartorius, pectineus. That's four that flex the hip. We have four that adduct the hip. Adductor longus, magnus, brevis, gracilis. So four and four so far. We'll break the tie. So now we'll talk about the muscles that are responsible for extending the hip. Here's what's funny about that. It's four of those. Four. Think about 4-4-4 to help you. So there are four muscles primarily responsible for extending the hip. Three of them are in a group. One of them stands alone as the largest muscle in the human body. It literally is the largest muscle in the human body. Matter of fact, it's this huge muscle right here on the back of the hip. This almost feels like I'm assaulting this skeleton. That's a point we won't grab. There we go. This muscle, the gluteus maximus. Gluteus maximus. So it's the largest muscle in the human body, the gluteus maximus. It only gets that distinction because of where it inserts, and we'll make that make sense in just a minute. So the gluteus maximus, it is a large, thick, functional muscle. Matter of fact, you have a gluteus and it's firing because you're sitting in that chair. If it wasn't, then your butt cheeks would be hurting and you'd be sloshing around going, ah, my cheeks hurt. Ah, this chair is so uncomfortable. So gluteus maximus, vitally important. So what about glutes? It's going to originate on the posterior aspect of the sacrum, the coccyx, and the ilium. So it runs like this, posterior sacrum, coccyx, which would be down here, ilium. So it's going to originate like this and then come across. So it doesn't take up the whole pelvis. Most people think glute max means it's going to take up this whole surface area of the hip. It doesn't. It's like this, where my fingers are going. Posterior sacrum, coccyx, ilium. It's like that. And comes across going lateral. So it starts medial, goes lateral, heading toward the femur. Posterior ilium, posterior coccyx, posterior sacrum. It's going to insert on the distal femur, and so let's start from proximal. Proximally, it's going to insert on the greater trochanter of the femur, and after it attaches to the greater trochanter, it's going to then slide its way over and attach to the iliotibial band, which we've talked about before. So it's going to insert on the iliotibial band. Here we go. So you can see it here. So it's going to insert on the greater troch, and then it inserts on the iliotibial band, which makes it run the length of the femur. So it's the largest muscle because they count. the actual length of the iliotibial band, or the IT tract, or the IT band. So it's going to insert on greater troch, and then the IT band. Remember, IT band is not going to insert until below the knee. So it has a huge surface area because of that. So gluteus maximus, posterior ilium, now posterior sacrum, posterior coccyx, posterior ilium. It's going to insert on the greater trochanter and the IT band. Functions, it's a prime mover in hip extension. So it's the opposite of iliopsoas, it's the iliopsoas of hip extension. Let me call it that. It's the prime extender of the hip. No matter what position the hip is in, no matter what position the knee is in, gluteus maximus will extend the hip. It is the prime extender of the hip. Innervation, inferior gluteal nerve. Inferior gluteal nerve, which means there will be a superior gluteal nerve we'll learn about later on. Okay, and it also does hip external rotation. So you can put your hands on your glute max, rotate your hip into external rotation, put your hands where it should be, rotate, and you will feel glute max assisting in hip external rotation. So it's a huge external rotator of the hip. Okay, so that's one extender of the hip, or the prime extender of the hip. The other three extenders of the hip, I don't know if we'll cover it here. We may cover them in, nope, we will cover them here. Skip these. The other ones are these three fellas, collectively called the hamstring muscles. The hamstring muscles. So it's a group of three muscles that we affectionately call the hamstring muscles. Semimembranosus, semitendinosus, and biceps femoris, long and short head. Semimem, semiten, biceps femoris, long and short head. The hamstring muscles. They're going to cover majority of the posterior leg. So those are the long muscles here on the posterior aspect of the leg. Those are the hamstring muscles. Semimem, semiten, biceps femoris, long and short head. Okay. So here's the cool thing about the three hamstring muscles. All three of them will originate on the same place. So you don't have to learn new origins for either of them. They're all going to originate on the same exact place. All of them will originate. Okay. Okay. They're all going to originate on the ischial tuberosity. They're all going to originate on ischial tuberosity. The big hump down at the bottom of the pelvis. Right here. Right in this area here. That big knot there, ischial tuberosity. That's where we'll, all three of them will originate from there. Okay. Even though they all originate from there, all three will have different insertion sites, which make them move and function a little bit different. So, for semimembranosus is going to be the large one on the medial aspect of the leg here, semimembranosus. Ischial tuberosity is going to insert on semimembranosus. It's going to insert on the posterior proximal tibia. Semimembranosus, posterior proximal tibia. Its job is to perform not just hip extension, but it's also a primary flexor of the knee. So hip extension, knee flexion. Innervation, sciatic nerve. Don't worry about calling the tibial division, just sciatic nerve. So semimembranosus, then from there we have semitendinosus. It's going to originate on ischial tuberosity. It's going to actually run medial as well, but it's going to cross on the anterior side, and it's going to insert on pes and serinus along with the other two muscles we've learned, sartorius and gracilis. So sartorius, gracilis, semitendinosus, pes and serinus. Same action, same nerve. Only thing that changes about these is where they're going to insert. And then lastly, biceps femoris. Biceps femoris is going to run, still the same origin, ischial tuberosity, but it's going to track lateral, and it has two components. It has a long head and a short head. Both will insert on the head of the fibula or the fibular head. And it has one of these weird two nerve innervation things. The long head is going to originate, it's going to be innervated by the tibial, the sciatic nerve with the tibial division. Short head is going to be innervated by the name change, which is the common peroneal or common fibular nerve. Old people are going to call it peroneal. Some folks will call it peroneal. Semitendinosus. So they'll usually take a sliver off of semitend and use that for that. Good question. So these are really cool things that go on, these dual innervations. Okay. All So those are the three muscles that will extend, well, the four muscles that extend. So we have four flexors: iliopsoas, rectus femoris, sartorius, pectineus. Four flexors. We have four adductors. We have adductor magnus, longus brevis, gracilis. We have four extenders. We have hip, we have gluteus maximus, and the three sciatic nerve, the three hamstring muscles. When it comes to abduction, we now start to break the cycle because we only have three muscles that are going to abduct the hip, abduct. Three muscles that are going to abduct the hip. Okay. One of the primary muscles that abducts the hip is going to be the gluteus medius muscle. So we've learned about glute max, but now we'll learn about glute med. Gluteus medius muscle. Shockingly, it is a vertical muscle laying on the lateral aspect, posterior lateral aspect of the ilium. So it's going to line up like this on the ilium. So it's the one that's actually closest to the iliac crest. So it's lining up like this, vertical, coming down to its insertion. So almost like that on the lateral side. Posterior lateral, not pure lateral, posterior lateral. Okay, so it's going to originate outer surface of the ilium. It's going to insert on the greater trochanter. So it's going to insert on the hip greater trochanter. It's like the greater tubercle. Its job is to perform hip abduction, abduction, but it's also a hip internal rotator as well. So when I'm moving to internal rotation, I'm using glute med. It's innervated by the superior gluteal nerve. Then we have gluteus minimus, which will be deep to gluteus medius. I need to say that again, because that's a whole lot of weird wordings. That almost sounds like a tongue twister. So gluteus minimus is deep to gluteus medius. So minimus is going to be deep to minimus. No, minimus is going to be deep to medius. So let's show you a picture here. It's a good picture here. So on this picture, you can see gluteus medius and how it blends in with gluteus maximus. Medius here near the superior surface of the ilium, that's the iliac crest right here. So right there, that bone right there is iliac crest. Remember, the crest is what you feel when you put your hands on your hip. So hands on your hip position, that's iliac crest. Glute med is right there off of that. Then glute max blends in from there. If you reflect or take off glute max and glute med, gluteus medius, you'll then expose gluteus minimus. Again, because it's deep to gluteus medius. It literally sits right behind it, or deep to it, I should say, not right behind it, sits deep to it. It's going to also be lateral surface of the ilium, still greater trochanter, same insertion sites as glute med, except it's just smaller. It doesn't attach to the almost to the crest of the ilium. It's kind of middle ways here. So it's not the crest, it's kind of middle way. Same actions, abduction, internal rotation. Same nerve supply, superior gluteal nerve. Okay. So those are two muscles that will abduct the hip. Let's add in one more. One of the cool names again that I like to talk about, the tensor fascia lata. Tensor fascia lata. Tensor fascia lata is going to originate lateral to the ASIS. So it's not pure ASIS. It's not right here on the front of ASIS. So that would be the front of ASIS right there. So it's kind of lateral to it. ASIS. And it's going to insert on the IT band, running its way down the lateral side of the leg. And it also abducts, but it does it with flexion. So if you kick forward and out to the side, like so, that's going to be TFL doing a lot of the work. So it does do abduction, but it does it with a blend of flexion. Tensor fascia lata, or TFL. Most people abbreviate it and just call it the TFL muscle. Okay. The last thing we'll pick up from there are the muscles that are responsible for performing hip external rotation. So these are going to be the deep muscles in the hip that aid glute max in doing hip external rotation. So there are six of them. Six muscles that all help to do hip internal rotation. I think obturator internus may do the other way. Okay. So the best way, so we'll treat them like the muscles that we did for the prevertebrals. So you definitely need to know the name of them all. There's one that we're going to really learn about that I'm going to be very specific about, which is called the piriformis. It's the most specific one of the six. But we'll learn it from what the book is giving us here under the word deep rotators, page 306. The book says there are six small, deep, mostly posterior muscles that span the hip joint in a horizontal direction. So when you look at them, they're all going to be running kind of horizontal. Okay. They work together to produce hip external or hip lateral rotation. As a group, they're termed the deep rotator muscles. Adaptive shortening of the piriformis can compress the sciatic nerve, causing pain to radiate down the back of the leg. So let's talk about that. So it's going to be the only one we're going to learn pretty specifically. So piriformis is going to originate on the anterior aspect of the sacrum. So when you're looking here, sacrum here, it's going to originate in here like this, on the anterior aspect where my fingers are. That's where it's going to originate, anterior aspect of the sacrum, almost like subscapularis. Anterior aspect of the sacrum. It's going to then come out from there and it's going to insert on the greater trochanter. So it's going to come out and it's going to insert on the greater trochanter. It's a great picture over here. It's the one right here. Piriformis. Piriformis, piriformis. Muscle right there. Middle of the butt cheek. Mid to lower part of the butt cheek. Piriformis. Now, why is that one important? I'm glad you asked. The book kind of gave it away. But here's something cool. If you look right underneath piriformis, there's a yellow structure here which indicates that this is a nerve. This yellow nerve right underneath piriformis is the sciatic nerve. So when the piriformis is hypomobile or not moving particularly well, it can start to put pressure on the sciatic nerve. Now, sciatic nerve can make it worse depending on where it actually exits the spine. So here is showing sciatic nerve originating or sciatic nerve coming in below piriformis. So it comes out below piriformis. But on a select group of people, sciatic nerve has been found to either exit above piriformis, so it'll come out up here, superior, and come down, which makes it even more susceptible to being pinched. Or in a small group of people, sciatic nerve actually exits directly through piriformis. So it can actually exit through the muscle going down the leg. So you can imagine if that muscle becomes hypomobile, does not move well, does not move normal, it will put a tremendous amount of pressure on sciatic nerve, and give you nerve symptoms down your leg. Things like numbness, tingling, burning, loss of function, those are usually nerve signs. Okay, any questions there? Are we at about 10:45? Okay, so let's talk a little bit about something that I skipped because I really wanted to get some understanding in before I started to come back and talk about this. So we're going all the way back to page 293, and we're going to talk about angle of inclination and femoral torsion. Okay. Okay. So page 293. We're going to start over there on the paragraph to the right, near the top. It says orientation of the head and neck of the femur in relationship to the femoral shaft affects the positioning of the head of the femur within the acetabular alignment. So what it's talking about, let's make this all make sense. there is an angle form between the head. So this is the femoral head here. This is the femoral neck here. So this portion here is the neck. This is the shaft. So head, neck, shaft. The angle that's formed between these three can affect the position of the hip in the acetabulum and weight bearing. So if the normal angle of inclination, if you take a protractor or goniometer and measure this, is about 125 degrees. You go vertical on the shaft, go horizontal off of the shaft onto the femoral neck and femoral head, you should get an angle of inclination about 125. That's what you're seeing here with the red lines. So you see the shaft, find the midpoint of the proximal shaft, and then you're looking at the midline of the head and neck as it runs through. So you have the shaft, vertical, and then you have the orientation of the head and neck as it comes through. Normal angle of inclination should be 125 degrees. Okay. Okay. When I have less angle of inclination, let's say this now flattens off and it's coming across here instead of it being like this, the head and neck, it's like this coming straight across. So if I have that happen with my femur, then I develop what's called coxa vara. Coxa vara. It's a term to say when I don't have enough angle of inclination, or my angle of inclination is less than the normal amount. Coxa vara. If I have more angle of inclination than 125, so let's say this here is making up 125, and now I have more inclination, so it's like that. It's more vertical instead of being here. If I have that, I have what's called coxa valga. Coxa valga. And those will be important because if I have one or the other of those, they're going to eventually cause knee deficits. So if you ever see people who are knock-kneed or people who are bowed legs, it could be coming from the angle of inclination at the hip. And we'll talk about which one gives you which once we get to the knee. But if I have knocked knees, meaning my knees touch together, my feet are apart, so I look like that, knocked knee, you'll see people like that. Or if I have bowed legs, it could have something to do with the angle of inclination of my hip. Okay, so it deals with the angle of the shaft versus the angle of the head and neck, drawing a midline through the head and neck of the femur. Then the last thing is femoral torsion that we'll talk about. Femoral torsion, it's the angle between the shaft and the neck of the femur, not in just a vertical plane, but in the horizontal plane. So this is the angle of the head, the angle that the shaft and the head of the femur forms with the acetabulum. Okay. So femoral torsion is the angle that is formed, with the head and the shaft, the head and neck of the femur, the femoral shaft with the acetabulum. acetabulum. Okay. All righty. And we'll get you some clarity there. It can give me femoral antiversion or femoral retroversion. And we'll talk a little bit about more about that as we dive into it. But just right now, no torsion deals with femoral head and neck and its position with the acetabulum. Okay. All right. That's a good place to break there. Again, we'll come back at 1. So I'll set the stage. We'll give you what we're